Hi, I'm Dan Gresley. This is Guitar Interactive Magazine, and we are super proud to welcome blues impresario Robin Trower to, well, it's not actually our sofa this time, it's the Fender sofa here at John Henry's. How are you,
Robin? Good, thanks.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Obviously, we're here today to talk about a new record that came out in March.
Yeah.
The record's called Coming Closer to the Day. I know you're on round 7 or 8 of interviews today. And we're going to start with a sort of general question before we get into the nitty-gritty of the guitar stuff and just talk a bit about how the record came about and the inspiration, about how you keep it fresh after so many years of playing and writing.
Well, I think the main thing about Coming Closer to the Day is I try to bring through a lot of my early influences, you know, rhythm and blues, rock and roll, blues, all the stuff that kind of formed me as a musician, and I tried to let that bleed into what I was doing more than I have done before. And the main thing was once that I've written the material and had a good idea of what I wanted to achieve with it, was I wanted to make sure that every track had a real feeling of performance about it.
Mm-hmm.
So that was the key. I won't say I'm 100% sure I pulled that off, but you know, that was what I was trying to achieve.
And in terms of those, because listening to the record, and what struck me is compared to some of the previous stuff, is that it's actually quite dry. It's a very dry sounding record in terms of your guitar sound.
Yeah.
Not a lot of reverbs used. It's very open and very kind of, it would be easy for that to sound bad, but it sounds really, really tight and really sort of in your face. Was that kind of an intentional thing to go dry with the record?
Yeah, definitely. The way I wanted it, I wanted it to feel real.
Mm.
In other words, not to try and enhance the sound and performance, because the sound and performance go together. You know, the guitar tone and the performance are one thing.
Mm-hmm.
So if you try and enhance it, then you're changing, however slightly, you're changing what you were saying when you put it down. So I wanted to try and keep close to that, you know.
So in terms of your, you mentioned your guitar tone there, and it instantly hit me when you started playing at the first track. I was like, wow, this sounds really, like, really saucy. And I wondered what the setup you used in the studio was for that.
Well, it's always Marshalls,
always
my Strat. The Marshalls I used, there's various combinations, there's always combinations, and it's never just one amp. There's combinations of my vintage modern 100, or I also used the new reissue 800, JCM 800.
Lovely, yep. The little one?
No.
Oh, but the, right, okay.
The 100, yeah.
Yeah.
I use that, I say that's predominantly the 100 that I used on the album. And also Blues Breaker.
Graham.
Through a Tuba 12 vintage 30s. In other words, not through its own speakers.
Right, okay. And how does that change the sound from your perspective, running it like that?
The greenbacks that are in the Blues Breakers are a bit soft.
Right, okay.
Yeah, they're very warm, but it's very hard to get real hard body into the sound.
The definition and
yeah, definition.
Crack.
Yeah. So I will put it through. I've got two by 12 that Marshall's built for me, in actual fact, with the vintage 30s in.
Yeah. Good old Marshall.
Yeah.
And in terms of miking up that when you were in the studio, I know you've got a studio you use quite regularly.
Yeah.
Did you play around with mic positions to get different ambiences, or was it close mic'd?
It's mostly pretty close mic'd. I mean, not right up. And usually on the loud amp, if I'm using 100, that would be a 57.
Mm.
And on the Blues Breaker, being a quieter amp, there would be a ribbon mic on that.
Right, okay. Yeah. And in terms of when you're, because I was listening to the record and it feels obviously completely worked out, but at the same time live and raw and improvisational.
Yeah.
And I wondered how much, obviously you start with the writing process where you put in the guitar ideas together, the lyric ideas. And when you go into the studio, how much have you worked out in terms of performance before you start putting takes down?
Some songs are really worked out, you know. And then there'd be others that I'd go in, put it down, put the song down, finish it, be unhappy with it, and just go back to start from scratch and start again if it wasn't what I wanted. You know, sometimes you can be sure the idea you've got is that's it, and then when you hear it back you think, no, that's not quite right. So what I would do, I change the arrangement, the guitar arrangement, change the key maybe even, you know, until it settles into something that I think is pulling off the actual song, is putting that across,
serving the song more. Because what's interesting is listening to your playing, and it sounds better than it ever has, is quite amazing, you know, because often, you know, you find with as players, you know, get to the twilight of their playing years, sometimes they lose that edge, and it seems that your playing never has, and especially on this record, it seems to be really cutting almost as much as, you know, as much as it did back when you recorded your first two albums.
I think, as I say, I set out to try and make the most soulful record I could make, and I think for me to feel like I'm playing soulfully, there's a hell of a lot of energy goes into it, you know. That fire's got to back it up, you know, otherwise I think it starts to sound jazzy, you know what I mean? Which is good in itself, but it's not what I want to pull off, you know.
So how do you, from a recording, well, even live and recording, but how do you, is there a kind of state of mind you have to get your, you know, when you find, you know, you must have moments where it's like everything connects, the, you know, the antenna connects with the universe and you channel that kind of real raw spirit of the blues. Is there anything after so many years of playing the blues that you can put that down to?
I think it's a weird thing to say, but I just think it's inside me. So I pick up a guitar and that's what comes out. I don't think, you know, obviously there is brain involved in that.
Yeah.
But I think it's much more the emotional side, what's going into it, that makes it what it is.
Yeah, because it seems, I mean, one of the things that's always struck me about your playing, Robin, is that there's so much space. And it's a rare quality, actually, in a lot of modern blues players, but even blues players in the past, was to overplay and play through everything. And the counterpoint in your playing is something that I think adds a huge amount of gravitas. I wonder if is that something that just happens naturally? Is that something you set out to do?
I think there's definitely a part of that does happen naturally. But also I think I have a very strong compositional sense, even with my lead playing. So I think that feeds into it, you know, the song is a composition, the top line that the vocal's doing is part of the composition, and also the lead, the solos in the track itself are also part of the composition. They're not just like, these are the licks I've learned and I'm going to stick them on this, you know. And it's not like that at all.
Oh, but you can definitely hear that on the record. Great. It doesn't just sound like a box of licks.
I'm glad that comes
out. It really does. A lot of like lovely breaks and stuff like that, real great articulations on the things that, you know, you do so well. You spoke about the songwriting, and I wondered, you know, how do you keep that fresh after so many years? In terms of sitting down with the instrument, do you sit with an acoustic? Do you sit with a piano? How do you go about doing it?
It's always a Strat. Pick up a Strat, put it through an overdrive, you know, and it starts off just by doodling or enjoying, you know, playing some sort of free form thing or a blues. You might play a 12-bar blues or something. But that starts the juices flowing, and you know, then ideas will grow. Some days you get ideas, some days they don't, you know. But you know, once I get an idea, I've got a pretty good idea. As soon as that idea pops up, that I could turn it into a song.
Right.
You know, that's it.
And do you put that down on paper? Do you have a little
four track? No, I have a recorder, a Sony recorder that all my ideas go down on. And even if I move away from them, they're all there. I go back to them.
Right.
Because at the moment, I'm also writing, and have been, for a while, writing music for the thing with Maxi Priest as well.
Amazing.
So, you know, that's another set of ideas that are there to work on as we go along, sort of thing.
And how did that combination come about?
Well, Livingston Brown, who mixed the album before this one,
right,
for me, I was leaving his studio, and Maxi, who he produces, was coming in.
Mm.
And Max said to me, you know, what about getting together to write together, you know? So that's where it started, really.
And you've got quite a long history of doing those kind of collaborations. I know you did the famous one with Brian Ferry and various other people over the years. Is that just down to a happy accident, or were you always looking to work with other musicians as well?
Well, with Jack, it was something, you know, that I felt would be good to do, with Jack Bruce. So I pushed for that.
Mm.
Working with Brian Ferry, that was really just, he called me in to do a guitar session on something on his album that he was working on. And then he just asked me, out of that, we got on very well. He asked me if I would come in and work on the production side with him, because he produced himself, you know. So I was helping him do that.
Right, okay.
Yeah.
Is that something you would suggest to, you know, young players out there who might be watching, that it would be a good thing for them to do, to look to collaborate with other artists, that there's stuff to take from that?
I think there's, you know, you've got to choose your collaborators well. You know, they can't be just, you know,
any old charlatan.
Yeah, no, I mean, you can't be just, I like the way he plays. I think, you know, the best thing to do is if there's somebody you're thinking about collaborating with, is just to put your toe in the water and see how it works.
Mm.
Like I did with Max, you know, it's like we got together, we wrote a song, you know, and it grew out of that.
If it works, it works.
Yeah,
if it doesn't, it doesn't.
It wasn't like, oh, we'll get together and do an album. It was just like, let's write a song. You know?
You spoke earlier about how with this new record, you've kind of gone back to your roots a little.
Yeah.
I wonder whether do you reflect a lot on Bridge of Sighs in terms of, obviously that had such a huge impact on launching your career to the stratospheric sort of levels it went to. Do you have any sort of reflections on that now after so many years of it passing and having written this record? Is it something you reflect on much?
I don't think anything from Bridge of Sighs is feeding into the new album.
No.
No, I don't think so. I think what I tried to do was pull in my influences before Bridge of Sight, you know, before
the real roots
that I did that. Mm. Yeah, the real, you know, I'm talking about, you know, my mentors like Albert King, B.B. King, James Brown, Jimi Hendrix, you know, and all that stuff. I wanted to let it feed through into what I was doing on this album. I didn't want to say, oh, that's a bit so-and-so.
You know
what I mean? I didn't want to cut anything off because it was an obvious influence thing, you know what I mean?
Right.
So I let it all flow, because, you know, if I was enjoying playing it, that was good enough.
And that's all it needs to be,
yeah,
right?
That's right.
I suppose after, you know, such a long time in the industry and probably so many varied experiences, positive and negative, I wondered if there's anything that you know, in terms of the modern music industry, whether you've seen any huge changes in how it works. Obviously, there's the technological side, but I wonder whether, from an ethos point of view, you must have seen quite a few changes.
I've seen a lot of changes. The thing that worries me most about what I hear today is that it seems to have got very thin. You know, it's kind of, I mean, I'm not saying everything, because there are some good, really good things about, but there seems such a lot of stuff that is just surface. And too many things are just sort of bits of this and bits of that, and don't have a feeling of an overall
sense of self authenticity or something like that.
I can't put it into words really, but it just seems things have got a bit thin.
Mm.
Yeah.
So for the young players out there who are, you know, learning and practicing and probably interested in maybe trying to take it to the next level. With that in mind, about authenticity and creating a rounded project, a rounded set of music, how did you approach that? Was it just something innate, or
Well, I mean, think you've got to be born with the gift.
That helps,
start,
guys.
To start off with. Yeah. But, I mean, what I always tell young players, and I think this was where I was very lucky, when I was learning to play, I either couldn't do it or had a sense that it was a good idea not to copy somebody else, not to sit down and work out somebody else's licks or parts. Because I think if you do that, that may cut off your own creativity.
Mm.
You could be taking yourself down a path by trying to play like so-and-so, you know, and you get stuck with that. You know, it may take longer for your own thing to come through because, you know, obviously, if technically you copy somebody, you're technically ahead of where you were. But it may take longer for your own thing to come through, but it may be better in the long term for you know, you what's the music I could make? Never mind about what
to create something player. Original.
Yeah. Mm. Where's the music that, you know, what have I got? And just keep working at it until you feel like you're actually saying it's you coming through rather than, because I think if you start trying to play like somebody, like if I'd have sat down and tried to play like, learn B.B. King's licks, I might have ended up sounding like, you know,
yeah, exactly,
being a B.B. King copyist, you know. I must say that players like him and Albert King, I was more interested really in what was behind the note, what made them play it like that, what was the emotion. That's the thing I was trying to get hold of rather than the actual technical side of it.
You know? Licks they were trying to play, yeah. And do you still now, when you sit down with the guitar, I mean, you know, learning the guitar, playing the guitar is a lifelong love, pursuit, curse, whatever you want to look at it, right?
Yes, yeah.
How do you, I mean, do you still pick up a music book and practice things, or is it now you've reached that level where you just, it free flows all the time and you don't need to do that?
I can't say I practice.
I'm not suggesting you need to study, Robert. I'm not saying
no, that. I can't say I really practice or... Obviously, I don't read music, so it's no good me picking up a book of music. But no, I think I honestly just think I play for fun, play for, you know, the joy it gives me. That's it, really, and that's what from out of that everything grows, you know.
Okay, and one final question: the piece of guitar equipment that got away, which one got away from you? Is there a particular thing in the history of your career you regret not buying?
No, I don't think so. I had a guitar stolen, which was probably the best guitar I'd ever owned and ever will own. It was a 56 Strat, and it just had such a beautiful musical sound to it. It was a very musical sounding guitar. Obviously, you know, the way it's put together, the wood, whatever, had a wonderful resonance to it, and that was stolen, so that's the one that got away for me.
That's the one that got away.
Yeah.
Whereabouts was it stolen? Where were you?
I was in LA at the time, yeah.
Well, if you're watching LA, we do have some American fans. If you're watching LA, and you can, what colour was it?
It was a Sunburst.
Sunburst.
With a maple neck.
With a maple neck. That plays really well.
Yeah.
Give us a call.
The 56.
Robin, thanks so much for your
time. My pleasure.
It's been great talking to you.
Thank you.
I'm Dan O'Grady. We'll see you next time.